I think we at SAP, we are famous for our industry knowledge. So whenever we go to a specific industry customer, we have templates, we have experts, we have a lot of experience to share from other customers. And this is a big benefit because this will lower the implementation costs because we come with templates. The customer, they have a faster time to market. So this is what they all need because it is a fast growing industry and they have one thing in common. They don't have enough time, not enough money, not enough people. So the best thing we can do, we help them to accelerate.
Welcome to this expert talk on battery manufacturing. This video is divided in some chapters. So first, you will learn details about the battery value chain and battery manufacturing industry. And at the end, you will hear the advantages of choosing SAP for a battery journey and many other insights. Here in the studio with me, we have Gerhard, my colleague, and we invited Stephan and Sebastian. They lead the SAP Global Battery Practice with various SAP experts. Thanks very much. Thank you very much for joining us. I will start directly with the first question to you, Stephan. So I think we can start by exploring the battery value chain. We know it's made of many different industries. So how does SAP support such a complex ecosystem?
First of all, SAP is supporting 26 industries in total, so it's a lot. And if you think about a value chain like automotive, where it starts with the tier suppliers, the car manufacturer, and finally the sales organization, that is how we try to support our customers with the end-to-end value chain knowledge. And the electrification of the industry creates a new value chain. And it starts with mining, it goes to active material, it goes to battery cell production, battery pack production, the OEMs, so the car manufacturers or two-wheeler manufacturers. Then we have the users, they need charging, we need the reuse phase, we need finally the recycling phase. So this is the value chain of the battery. And this is where we said it's a kind of an industry in itself. So, but we don't want to have a 27th industry, but we say let's take all we have out of the 26 industries and define a global battery practice. And that is what Sebastian and myself did 5 years ago, where we said, let's pull together the experts and let's serve all the customers along the value chain for electrification with this certain battery knowledge. That was the idea, basically.
Stephan, this sounds really interesting. You invested a lot of effort in this best practice. Can you explain a little bit, what is the benefit for the customers of your effort?
Yeah, I mean, I think we at SAP, we are famous for our industry knowledge. So whenever we go to a specific industry customer, we have templates, we have experts, we have a lot of experience to share from other customers. And this is a big benefit because this will lower the implementation costs because we come with templates. The customer, they have a faster time to market. So this is what they all need because it is a fast growing industry and they have one thing in common. They don't have enough time, not enough money, not enough people. So the best thing we can do, we help them to accelerate.
Uh-huh. Right. Sebastian, look, I have directly a question to you.
Yeah.
What do you understand by battery manufacturing? Mm. So typically, we are talking about component manufacturing, automotive supplier, and so on. Which part of the end-to-end value chain does this refer to?
Yeah, very good question, Gerhard. So when we talk about battery manufacturer, we need to differentiate really two different kind of entities in that whole value chain that Stephan already mentioned. So it's cell manufacturer that mm-hmm. we call battery manufacturer, and also then the ones who assembly those cells to modules and packs. You know? So this is what we define as battery manufacturer, but both have very different requirements and capability needs. You know? So when you talk about cell manufacturing, it's really high speed, high volume, with very few variants, right? So precision and efficiency is here really key. So they want to manufacture the same cell in the highest quality over and over again. Yeah? So that's all they need to do. Super complicated because it's also a combination of process and discrete manufacturing. Yeah? So that's really the challenge here. It starts with process manufacturing where you then in the end take liquids, they are mixed, you print on foils, and there are really chemical and material requirements that need to be solved. And it ends discrete then, right? So the coating, folding or winding, depending on the cell type, and then the assembly of the cell and the formation. So and it gets a serial number. So that's discrete manufacturing. So it's really the combination of both that is the challenge. Yeah? Mm. And it's the big, let's say, then also difference to assembling a component here is there's one single enclosed line where they manufacture those cells on. Yeah? So it's really a clean room and highest automation degree that is there. So all they need and want to do is enhance the throughput, the yield then in the end, and reduce human error by simply don't have any human in that process. Yeah? So data is key here, essentially, yeah? To optimize and influence real-time the shop floor parameters to secure the quality. That's the essence of cell manufacturing. Oh,
mm-hmm. Really interesting. And coming to the second part, you mentioned that you have also the module and pack.
Yeah. So the second part then of battery manufacturing is really the module pack assembly, where we take the cells into modules and then larger packs then in the end that then go into OEM, automotive, for example. Less volume, still big volume, bit more variance, but still not too complex in the variance, but needs of flexible and modular production, for example, when we talk about manufacturing capability. And also, suddenly, a software needs to be also produced because they need to be managed from a thermal perspective, and they also provide battery management system. Yeah, so quality tests, key high automation also there, and advanced robotics and AI driven systems really are key also here to enhance the assembly efficiency on those entities or the component manufacturers here.
Thanks for explaining. So we learned we have on one side the cell manufacturing, on the other part we have the module and pack. This brings me to another question to you. What is our approach and our strategy to help those customers?
Yeah. So we leverage standard SAP capabilities and functionalities without a need for any severe battery specific here. Our PLM, ERP and MES is fit for purpose for the battery industry where others might need battery specific capabilities. Yeah. So we already learned a lot that already has been done in other industries, like for example, the semiconductor industry that has the same requirements, high speed, high volume, same thing over and over again, same quality. So fit for purpose here. And we are already in that industry since ages. So the future success for battery manufacturers from our perspective is the ability to blend high automation with efficient processes, you know, and responding to both high volume demands and the complexities of the material chemistry. Yeah? So leveraging our existing suite frameworks, we can really maximize this operational efficiency while maintaining the adaptability in this fast-paced market.
What is the advantage of our customer to choose SAP at their partner for the battery manufacturing?
Yeah, that's a good question, Gerhard. So the primary reason really, and that's what we just heard, is our suite first strategy, really. So fully integrated suite of applications from supply chain to manufacturing to financials to HR to streamline all the processes, eliminate data silos, and then enhance the overall efficiency. Yeah, it's a unified platform, single source of truth, improving the decision making then also. And at the core, there is obviously then PLM, ERP, and MES, which is pivotal, yeah, but as an ecosystem suite, not each of those components standalone. There are too many interdependencies. So secondly, cloud first, right? So leverage the cloud solutions, have a scalable, and then being able to grow with the business needs, which reduces then also the burden of IT infrastructure and being able to stay agile. Now, finally, it's really our commitment to the concept of a digital thread. So creating this comprehensive and transparent flow of information across the entire value chain is essential to be able to, for example, have traceability and accountability, which are critical factors in battery production, especially concerning sustainability and compliance regulations. Mm-hmm. So only with that concept of a digital thread, which is embedded in our whole portfolio, for example, a battery passport regulation can be achieved easily. So to document and trace the entire life cycle of batteries from raw materials to end of life disposal, that is what we have supported with our digital thread concept.
Stephan, but how to start? What would be the first step for this journey?
They are all in a hurry. I mean, they have to start now. And very often they start with manage money, spend money, manage people, which means finance, procurement, HR. This is the first step. But it's also important to think about the bigger picture. So what we have seen very often is that I fully get it because they are under pressure. They don't have enough people. They have a day-to-day business and they don't have time or they don't take time to think about the bigger picture. So what is the roadmap ahead? This is one of the most important things. And as Sebastian already said, the data-driven approach is key. So we are talking to customers who decide to go with the classical PLM and MES providers, but the interface is more expensive than doing the implementation with SAP, more or less. I mean, this is key, and traceability is absolutely key. So that is what we see very often. I mean, they should have the big picture in mind, but start small and then adding more functionalities while they are growing. And this is the beauty of our solution.
Start small sounds really flexible. Can you elaborate a little bit more? What does this mean? Do we have a good example for starting small?
To be compliant, to run a company in a compliant way, you have to have a minimum set of capabilities in your finance system, for example, to be compliant. And this is where they did start with. I mean, they are so much focused on building the factory that some of them, you know, they are missing the big picture sometimes, right? And this is the important thing, that you synchronize the business plan or the business project plan, how the factory will grow, with the IT plan, because if you start with finance, then sooner or later the factory expects raw material to be delivered. It would be great that you have the capabilities in the ERP system available, right? And the MES system finally. And this is how we help our customers to build a roadmap, right? To say, okay, the next months to come, you should have the following capabilities. We discuss what is really needed, and then we help them to lay out the perfect plan to achieve this goal. That is what we do.
Mm-hmm. Stephan, do you have any learnings on this journey? Because you started with talking about the best practice, mm-hmm. You had to adjust a little bit.
What we see very often, that the startups, they are hiring experienced employees from bigger companies, and they have a certain heritage. They have they are socialized in big companies. They are not trained to run a startup very often. And it is important that they define, okay, what is it? What are our design principles? Cloud first, business first, no change, no development, because it's not needed. And it is not one big project, it's an implementation journey. And what I say sometimes is, perfect is the enemy of good. So stop debating the last 10% of functionality. Start with 80%. It's very often more than enough. So perfect is the enemy of good. So because it's a startup, they think in quarters or even half year timelines. And this is what we need to support, right? This is the most important thing, to be pragmatic a bit more.
Thank you.
Sebastian, would you like to add something here?
There's just one thing that we haven't talked about yet, and we kind of need to and will talk about it very much also in our strategy, is AI then. I think the only thing to add from my end would be with what we have discussed today, suite first, data consistency, and having this robust digital thread. That's the foundational framework then in the end for successfully implementing AI use cases, right? Yeah. So only with that we can harness the power, or our customers can harness the power of AI for even then more and better improved efficiency, innovation, and competitiveness. Yeah, so navigating those complexities with cutting edge intelligence and paving this way then forward for sustainable growth and success, only possible with those principles that we've just mentioned.
Very good. I think we reached the end of our talk. I want to say thank you very much, Gerhard, Sebastian, and Stephan, for joining us. I would like to invite you to please again check all the links we have in the description for you. We can learn much more about battery manufacturing. We also invite you to visit the SAP S/4HANA Cloud Public Edition community. There, you can get in touch directly with our SAP experts. And if you have any further question or suggestion for more topics, you can send us an email for insidesfor@sap.com. Thanks for watching. and hope to see you next time. Bye-bye.